Hello everyone. So I hope you all are doing good and staying safe. So today's topic is on countercurrent mechanism. So this is a repeated essay question in the university exam. So far we have got this question around 4 times in the exam. Okay. So see, in physiology, okay, I can't say this rule can be applicable for neuro, but for topics like these, okay, which we would have already been familiarized in our lower classes and all. Physiology, when you can score maximum marks, is not when you actually mug up a flowchart that is given in a textbook, you try to vomit it in the exam, or you just mug up a content from a textbook and you try to vomit it in the exam. Always remember, when you are trying to actually understand the author's flowchart, then it is actually going to be difficult for you. Okay, so always remember, physiology is concerned, as far as physiology is concerned, study something and interpret your understanding in form of a flowchart. Okay, because when you design your own flowchart, you will not forget that for a long period of time. Wherein, just imagine you just study a flowchart from a textbook, you go for the exam. Okay, that is a 10-step flowchart and you forget the 5th step there. So one, if you are forgetting the 5th step, automatically other steps will also start winding up. Okay, so it will just go just like that. Okay, then the entire question will be standing. Okay, without a proper basement. So please remember, you try to study like a story, how you study a storybook, and try to interpret your understanding in form of a flowchart. That will really help you. And my session is also going to be the same way, wherein instead of you studying a story, I'm just going to narrate a story. That's it. Okay, that's the basic difference in my session now. So we'll get started. So what I thought was, okay, why should I directly jump into the mechanism? So I just wanted to give you a broad idea of what kidney is doing. Okay, so for which I would just like to do some annotations. See, please understand, we will have two things. Okay, as I said, story, we'll just talk like a story. So your hot summer, okay, so you went out. Okay, so you were standing in hot sun for about 1 hour, you come home. Okay, so you consume more amount of water. Okay, so the entire day you are consuming more amount of water. So which means what you are trying to do actually, you have increased the water load in our body, right? So you are trying to increase the volume of water in our body. So please remember, in our body, any constituent, if it is going to be more or less, both are dangerous. So body tries to balance the constituent to an optimum level. Okay, so how kidney works is, it is actually going to do two things. One is what is called as your dilution of urine. Another one, what is called as your concentration of urine. What are they? There is going to be two things operating: dilution of urine, concentration of urine. So when you consume more amount of water, your urine is going to be diluted. Okay, so if I want to tell it in a layman's language, I can say your urine is going to appear lighter in color, or I can say white in color. I can't say white, so I can just say lighter. Okay, so it is going to appear pale in color or light in color, all that. Okay, similarly, if you take in as concentrated urine, if you take, so in a winter season, or you stay in an air conditioned room for the entire day, so we generally do not tend to take water. Okay, so our consumption, it is going to decrease when we stay in a cool atmosphere. Okay, so in that point of time, our kidney is going to replenish the lost levels. Okay, so by doing some mechanism, so that is going to be reflected as a concentrated urine that is going to more of like appear yellow in color. Okay, so if you take, then what is the normal concentration of a urine? I have told the two extremes, a diluted urine and a concentrated urine. You do everything properly. Okay, then what is it? So please understand, our concentration of urine is going to be expressed in form of a unit called as osmolarity. What is it? Osmolarity. Okay, so we express it as a milliosmoles per liter. So this will be a unit that will be encountering everywhere. Okay, so now we'll just go a little bit higher. So I hope you all have understood the basic concept. So kidney is going to actually do two phenomena, a dilution and a concentration. Okay, so this is the first thing I wanted to tell. So next, very important, if you take, a solution. Okay. So if you take a solution, you all know it, I've studied in your chemistry, in your lower classes. A solution contains two components, a solute and a solvent. Solvent is the liquid form, solute is the solid form. Okay. So similarly, if you take, in our body also, we have this fluid. So any fluid is also going to contain a solute and a solvent. Okay. So if you see, this dilution and concentration is also explained as a function of a solute and solvent. Okay, as a function of solute or solvent. So I'll just give you an example. So if you take under a normal physiological condition, okay, which means you do not have any underlying kidney disease, or you do not have a diabetes or any form of disease you do not have. Okay, then that is a normal physiological condition. Okay, so under normal physiological condition, this dilution and concentration of urine, it is a function of your solvent. So if you take the example that I gave you just now, you go out for a walk or something in a hot summer day. Okay, so you feel thirsty, so you come, you drink lots of water for the entire day. Similarly, I gave you another condition wherein you sit, you spend your entire day in an air-conditioned room or in a cool atmosphere. Okay, so your consumption of water is less, so you get a concentrated urine. So under normal physiological condition, if you take, this dilution and concentration has become a function of a solvent, which means it is going to be purely dependent on the water intake. Similarly, if you take in a pathological condition, okay, say you have a diabetes mellitus, okay, or some pathological condition, so or some proteinuria, amaturia, there are some diseases, okay. So what is going to happen? The solute molecules will start appearing in the urine. For example, okay, if there is a glomerulonephritis or an acute kidney damage, you will have this blood component coming in the urine. I hope you all would have done this urine analysis in your biochemistry. Okay, you test for proteins, you test for heme, okay, you test for bile, you test for glucose. Okay, so if you remember glucose, you do with Benedict's test and all that, right? So if there is a pathological condition underlying, then this dilution and concentration of urine is going to purely depend on your solute. Okay, so in physiological condition, we have the solvent, and in your pathological conditions like your diabetes or a kidney disease or glomerulonephritis, we have this solute that is going to be determining the concentration of the urine. Okay, so understand this basic concept. And the next thing that I wanted to tell you all is the constituents that that the kidney is actually considering for these process. If you want me to tell, I can say we have this sodium, or I can say sodium chloride, NaCl, okay, and its ionic constituents, okay, water, and then urea. So these three are the main components that the dilution and concentration of urine revolves around. Okay, so some changes in these ions, in the kidney, in the interstitium we'll be talking about. So all these are actually what is going to determine the concentration of the urine. And for all these processes, if you remember, I told you, right, dilution, concentration, all this, there is a master. Okay, if you take, who is the master here? He is the ADH. So if you take this ADH, which stands for antidiuretic hormone, and is going to be from the posterior pituitary, is the hormone that is actually going to govern this reabsorption, okay, and all this dilution, concentration, everything is going to revolve around this, a beautiful hormone that has been found, that is ADH. Okay, so I just want you all to understand this basic thing, or I just want you guys to get oriented to what is dilution, what is concentration, in physiological condition, what is the factor determines, in pathological condition, what factor determines, this is a very important question, what are the normal components that is involved in this phenomenon, and what is the hormone. I hope you are all clear with the basic. Just keep revolving your minds around this basic concept, then your countercurrent mechanism is going to be very easier. Okay. So before getting into it, I just wanted to touch upon the anatomy, a basic anatomy. So we all know our kidney is going to be divided into an outer cortical region. So this is your outer cortex. Okay. And then an inner medullary region. Okay, and this is your renal pyramid that is going to be enlarged part of, sorry, renal pelvis that is going to be an enlarged part of your ureter. Okay, and then if you take within your medulla, you will be having all these pyramids and all that. Okay, so just I just wanted you all to understand this. We have two parts, a cortex and the medulla. At least you have to know that. Okay, so an outer cortex and then an inner zone of medulla. Okay, this is enough. Remaining things you learn in anatomy. Okay, now this is what actually as a physiologist you must be very thorough with this. Okay, so if you take, as I told you, a kidney is going to be divided into an outer cortical region and inner medullary region. And the functional and the structural unit of kidney, as we all know, it is a nephron. Okay, so if you take, I hope you all know what are the parts of the nephron. So it is going to start with glomerulus, which is actually tuft of capillaries arising from your renal artery. And we have this Bowman's capsule, and that is going to extend into your proximal tubule. Okay, and then we have this loop of Henle, where we have descending limb of loop of Henle and ascending limb. Ascending limb will be having two parts, a thin segment of ascending limb and the thick segment of ascending limb. And then you have your distal tubule, and then we have a cortical collecting tubule, medullary collecting tubule, and then collecting duct. Okay, so if you are understanding, this collecting duct is going to be in the inner medullary zone. The remaining portion we actually call it as a tubule, and only the portion that is going to be present in the innermost aspect of the medulla is called as a duct. Please understand, this is a picture taken from Guyton. Okay, so the innermost part is your collecting duct. Okay, so these are the parts of the nephron I want you all to understand. I hope you all know what is a cortical nephron and is extramedullary nephron. So if you take cortical nephrons, the loop of Henle is going to be within the cortex, or it is going to penetrate very little into the medulla. Okay, so if you take, I can say this is your cortical nephrons, which means what? Corticomedullary nephron means I can say that is going to be more related to your cortex, and this is your juxtamedullary nephrons. Okay. Next, we are moving on. So to the countercurrent mechanism, we are just moving. So if you take this part, so how will you start this? Concentration dilution of urine takes place. I have told this point already. And what are the factors that is actually going to govern is your ADH. Okay. And then hyperosmolarity and gradient in the medullary interstitium of the kidneys. Very important. Okay. So we have spoke about ADH. Okay. That is going to actually help you in water reabsorption and all that. Now, this one more very important factor that is the purpose of studying countercurrent mechanism is this hyperosmolarity and a gradient in the medullary interstitium. Okay, so if you take hyperosmolarity, which means more concentration, and gradient, which means some interstitial gradient is going to be a difference between two entities, right? That is a gradient. So hyperosmolarity and gradient in medullary interstitium of the kidneys is the second important factor for this concentration and dilution. Okay, now why do we need this medullary gradient is because in the interstitium, the fluid that is going to be present, okay, the osmotic pressure of this fluid is the driving force for reabsorption of water from distal tubules and the collecting duct. That's a very important point. What he is trying to say is, see, we all know there is going to be reabsorption phenomenon taking place for concentrating the urine. Okay, or in physiologically, there is going to be some part of reabsorption. If you would have studied in this, glomerular filtration. Okay, 180 liters of urine will be formed per day, but only 1.5 liters is going to be excreted. So 99% of the fluid is going to be reabsorbed. Okay, so how this reabsorption is going to take place is because of this medullary gradient. Okay, so because of this concentration gradient between your tubules and then your interstitium, there is movement of substances across that. Okay, so that is what he's trying to tell here. This osmotic pressure is very important as the driving force for reabsorption of water from DTS and then collecting duct. Okay, so what is this picture actually depicting is, please understand, the normal plasma osmolarity. Okay, so in a physiological condition, you have given adequate amounts of input to your body. So if you take the normal plasma osmolarity, is going to be 300 milliosmoles per liter. Usually, physiology means, please remember, you should tell it in a range. Okay, so 285 to 300 milliosmol per liter. This is the normal plasma osmolarity. Okay. Now, what the kidney is doing, I told you there's going to be an hyperosmolar medullary interstitium, right? So, if you take in medulla, you are having some 1200 value, which means approximately the plasma fluid or the fluid that is entering into your proximal tubule and all, when it reaches the medulla, it is being concentrated for about 4 times. So if you take this medullary interstitial value can range between 1200 to 1400 milliosmol per liter. Okay, this is the next thing that you must understand. Okay, so from cortex to medulla, this is the thing. Okay, so approximately 4 times the concentration of the fluid is going to increase. And if you remember me telling you, this NaCl, water, urea, these are playing some important role in the mechanism. Okay, so with this, all these introductions that I have given you so far, we are moving on to the countercurrent mechanism. Okay, so what is this? A very important definition which you will give in your introduction. A system in which the inflow is parallel to and counter to outflow, which means opposite. Okay, so if you take G.K. Pal, he actually gives a very good side heading called requirements of a countercurrent system. Okay, so for a countercurrent system to operate, you will require 2 tubes. Okay, first thing, you will require 2 tubes. And these 2 tubes, okay, so the flow of fluid in these 2 tubes should be in opposite direction. This is the second rule. What is that? It should be in the opposite direction. And the third important requirement is these 2 structures should be in close proximity. So it's better you include the side heading also. What are the requirements? You require 2 tubes, and in that 2 tubes, the fluid should be flowing in an opposite direction. And then also these 2 tubes should be in close proximity. So these are the 3 requirements for a countercurrent system. So a system in which the inflow is parallel to, counter to outflow, and we have seen the requirements. So if we take what are the components of the system, we are going to have a countercurrent multiplier and a countercurrent exchanger. So we spoke that we have this hyperosmolarity and medullary interstitium that has been created. Okay, 4 times it has been concentrated. Okay, so there is a structure that is going to actually multiply the concentration. If you take, I told you 4 times, right? So which means the concentration is keep on multiplying. Only if it is multiplying, it is arrived to 1200. So it is multiplied by 4 times. So that multiplication of the concentration is going to be concerned with a structure that is called as a countercurrent multiplier. Okay, so this countercurrent multiplier is responsible for creation of this medullary interstitium. What is that? For creating this hyperosmolarity gradient in the medulla, this is responsible. Okay, I'll just change it to the pen. Okay, and then if you take, we have this countercurrent exchanger that is responsible for maintenance of this hyperosmolar gradient that has been created. So there is one structure that is going to actually create a hyperosmolar gradient, and there is another structure that is actually going to maintain this created gradient. So that is your countercurrent exchanger, and countercurrent multiplier is meant for creation. So if you take here, I have put 2 pictures, right? So one is loop of Henle, let's pump. Another one is your vasorecta. So this is concerned with your hyperosmolar gradient creation. Okay, loop of Henle is responsible for creation of this hyperosmolar gradient, whereas this vasorecta, which is actually a set of capillaries that is going to actually maintain the created hyperosmolarity gradient. Okay, so we'll just see how all this happens. So this is a picture taken from Guyton. You must draw this diagram in your exam. This will give you maximum marks. Okay, so we'll just start with the story. Okay, so I told you normal plasma osmolarity is going to be 285 to 300 milliosmoles per liter. So we have considered this 300 milliosmoles per liter. Okay. And please understand one point alone. These structures that we saw, okay, this loop of Henle is, I can say it has a potency or a ability to create a concentration gradient of about 200 milliosmoles per liter. It's again a statement taken from Guyton. So if you take the space, I hope you all know what is an interstitium, right? So the space between any 2 structures is called as an interstitium. So this is actually your interstitium. So if you observe these pictures everywhere, if you take almost the concentration gradient, gradient means what? It will difference, right? So everywhere is somewhere around 200 milliosmole per liter, 350, 150, 500, 300, 1800, 1200, 1000. So these structures has a capacity of creating a concentration gradient of about 200 milliosmoles per liter. Start with this point, that will actually impress the examiners. I can say we will start. So I told you the incoming fluid is going to be a plasma fluid. It is going to have an osmolality of 300 milliosmoles per liter. Okay, and one more basic thing that you must understand here is we saw descending limb of Loop-Henle and ascending limb of Loop-Henle. An ascending limb of Loop-Henle, if you take, we add this thin segment and thick segment. So on the top region, we add this thick segment, and in the bottom part, we add the thin segment. Please understand, this descending limb of Loop-Henle is going to be permeable to water, which means through this descending loop, the water can be sent out of the fluid. Okay, so if you take, if this is your descending limb, water can actually move out from the descending limb. So what is going to happen? In the fluid, solutes are going to be no in the position, but water is going to displace. So as a result, what is happening? As the fluid flow downwards, the concentration is going to increase. So descending Loop-Henle is called as a concentrating segment, a very important MCQ. Okay, so descending Loop-Henle is permeable to water, impermeable to electrolytes. So it is called as a concentrating segment. Similarly, on the other way around, if you take, ascending limb is going to be permeable to electrolytes, but impermeable to water. So that is called as diluting segment. So wherein the concentration will slowly decrease. Okay, so with this knowledge we'll go. So fluid is going to come via your descending limb of Loop-Henle, and it is going to go via your ascending limb of Loop-Henle. Okay, now we will take this picture. So if you take, he has put lots of oval structures, right? So please understand, in the thick portion of your ascending limb, so we saw, right? So in the thick portion of your ascending limb, there is a special type of a transporter called as sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. What is that? Sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. So this is a transporter that is going to be present along the thick part of ascending limb. Okay, so the fluid is going to contain water, electrolytes, everything, right? So once it goes to a thick part of your ascending limb, the ascending limb that is permeable to electrolytes is going to diffuse into the interstitium by means of this sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. So if you take this particular channel that is placed here, is your sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. So what is happening in the second step? Once the fluid comes in contact with your thick part of your ascending limb, the solutes such as your sodium, potassium and chloride, they are going to diffuse into the medullary interstitium via this transporter. So now what is happening? A 200 milliosmole gradient is created between your ascending limb and then, know what? Your medullary interstitium. At the same time, what is happening? The gradient is created between this descending limb of Loop-Henle and also medullary interstitium. Are you able to understand? This ascending limb has done something, right? So it has sent some solutes. Excellent, very good. So there is a gradient created between the ascending limb and medullary interstitium, as well as a gradient created between your descending limb and then your medullary interstitium. So now what has to happen? Descending limb is not going to be silent. It says, whether you only can do something, even I can do something. So what it is going to do? I told you very well, this descending limb of Loop-Henle is permeable to water. So what it is going to do? It is going to send some water molecules into the medullary interstitium. So that what is going to happen is the concentration between your descending limb and then your medullary interstitium is the same. See, please understand, descending limb of Loop-Henle is not in favor of medullary interstitium. Okay, so it is aator of medullary interstitium. So somehow it wants to be in par with medullary interstitium, so it is not affected. So it will try to actually match the concentration in the medullary interstitium. So it is trying to send some water molecules so that this segment gets further concentrated and medullary interstitium gets further diluted. Are you able to understand this? So in the third step, descending limb comes and does its role. Meanwhile, what is going to happen? A new fluid is going to enter. What is going to happen? A new fluid is going to enter into descending limb. Thereby, what will happen? The distal part la iruka fluids all are going to go that side. Okay, inga nalla I'll just explain in Tamil one. So inga pathina oru 300 da irukku matha ellame 400, which means ascending limb ku counter ah ellame pannidichu. இப்ப என்ன அது புதுசா ஒரு ஃப்ளூயிட் வருது. சோ என்ன ஆயிடும், இங்க ஒரு 300 வருதா, அப்போ வாட் வில் ஹேப்பன், திஸ் 300 வில் கோ டவுன், திஸ் 400 வில் கம் ஹியர், திஸ் 400 வில் கம் ஹியர், திஸ் 400 வில் கோ டு தி அதர் சைட். சோ சைமல்டேனியஸ்லி ஒன்ஸ் திஸ் டிசெண்டிங் லிம்ப் கிவ்ஸ் அவுட் சம் வாட்டர், அட் தி சேம் டைம் வி ஹேவ் அ நியூ செட் ஆஃப் ஃப்ளூயிட் தட் இஸ் என்டரிங் இன்டு தி டிசெண்டிங் லிம்ப். ஆஸ் எ ரிசல்ட் தி ஃப்ளூயிட் தட் இஸ் பிரசன்ட் இன் தி பாட்டம் பார்ட் is going to be pushed to the other side. Pushed to the other side, nanna, to your ascending part. Okay, so what is going to happen? Again, the same phenomenon will happen. Okay, so here what is going to happen is, again it is going to send this sodium chloride potassium channel. Thereby again this medullary interstitium will be created. Again it gives water, it is going to stay in pass. So if you observe the pictures everywhere, between the medullary interstitium, the concentration is always maintained. So if you take 500, it is maintained the same, right? So this is what it is. Okay, so, excuse me, here, this box will not be valid here. Able to understand, ma? Okay, so this is what it is. Okay, so first, your fluid, descending limb is not going to affect the fluid. Once the fluid comes to your ascending part, via your sodium potassium chloride channels, it is the solutes move into medullary interstitium. So the 200 milliosmol concentration gradient is created between interstitium and then your limb. As a result, a descending limb is going to give something so that there is no gradient between descending limb and medullary interstitium. So there's going to be a new set of fluid coming in that is going to push the fluid in the descending limb to the ascending limb. So again, a new set of again, solutes from the sodium potassium chloride channel goes to medullary interstitium. Again, descending limb does this. So this cycle is going to continue till a value of 1200 or 1400 is going to be attained. Able to understand now what will happen again? So 500 will go there. Okay, so again, this will become 700, right? So this will become 400, this will become 600, this will become 400. So now 600 will come. I'll just draw here. I hope you don't understand if I just tell by words. Okay, so inga we have 500. So in the 500 will come here now. Vandhuruma, vandha enna agum? Inga you have 500. Okay, so this is going to give 100 units here. So this will become 600, this will become 400. So in the mari thirupi, these steps are going to repeat until a gradient of 1200 is created. Okay, very important. So this, draw this diagram and understand my story. So ascending limb, descending limb. Fluid moves to the other side. Again, ascending limb, descending limb. Fluid moves to the other side. This is a cycle in simple if you want me to tell. Okay, so this is about your countercurrent multiplier. Okay, and here actually we have something called single effect. Single effect is ascending limb, descending limb, okay, and the medullary interstitium. This is called single effect. Okay, that is once creation of this concentration gradient is called as a single effect. அதாவது ஐ கேன் சேம் திஸ் இஸ் யுவர் சிங்கிள் எஃபெக்ட் 1, 2, 3 ஆர் சிங்கிள் எஃபெக்ட். அதாவது ஃப்ளூவிட் போது அசெண்டிங் லிம்ப் இட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு சென்ட் டு தி மிடில் இன்டர்ஸ்டீஷியம், டிசெண்டிங் லிம்ப் இஸ் கோயிங் டு டூ சம்திங். திஸ் இஸ் அ சிங்கிள் எஃபெக்ட் அண்ட் திஸ் இஸ் வாட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு ரிப்பீட் கண்டினியூஸ்லி ஆஸ் தி ஃப்ளூவிட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு கம் இன் டு தி டியூபியூல்ஸ். ஓகே, ஸோ திஸ் சிங்கிள் எஃபெக்ட் தட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு மல்டிப்ளை கண்டினியூஸ்லி இஸ் கால்ட் ஆஸ் யுவர் கவுண்டர் கரண்ட் மல்டிப்ளையர். Are you able to understand why the term multiplier had come? See, 300 to 1200, right? So this is actually a countercurrent multiplier and this is called as a single effect. What is it called as? Single effect. Okay. I hope you understood. Now, next we will move on to role of, this is a very important picture. So far, if you take what I told you in the introduction, we have NaCl, we have water, we have urea that is going to contribute to this system. And here I have just explained you the roles of a sodium chloride and then water. I just spoke about descending limb, ascending limb. Then what about that urea? Please do not neglect that urea. For this concentration and dilution of urine, urea plays a role of about 40 to 50%. Again, a statement from Guyton. Guyton says, please do not stop your thinking with NaCl and water, which plays a major role in countercurrent system. You have a very important entity which plays an equal role, that is your urea. So urea plays around 40 to 50% role in your countercurrent system. So if you take distal tubules, it has some amounts of urea that is actually going to give. Okay, so it is very slightly permeable to urea. And even if you take cortical collecting tubules, are also slightly permeable to urea, not that much. Okay, to some extent, maybe I can say. Okay, and here even if you take proximal tubules, he has given, right? So some minute levels, I can say. But if you take around 40 to 50% of urea is going to be reabsorbed from the inner part or inner medullary collecting ducts. What is that? IMCD, inner medullary collecting ducts. Now the question comes, how this inner medullary collecting ducts is so efficient to allow this much of urea is because of some transporter called as, again, if you see this oval structure, urea trans UTS. So we have some structures called as UTA. Okay, so actually we have two things, ma. Okay, this again it can be an MCQ. Okay, we have UT1. Okay, this is UTA. And then UTB, that is urea transporter A and then urea transporter B. I'll just touch upon this because you have MCQs there. Please understand, UTA, urea transporter A, is responsible for reabsorption of urea from your kidneys. Okay, very important MCQ. I got it from Guyton. Okay, so UTA is responsible for reabsorption of urea from your kidneys, whereas your UTB is responsible for reabsorption of your urea from your RBCs. Okay, very important MCQ. And if you take this UTA itself is of four types, like UTA 1, UTA 2, UTA 3, UTA 4. And UTA 1 is the one that plays a vital role in this urea reabsorption from your tubules. Okay, so from the inner medullary collecting ducts, we have majority of the urea that is going to be reabsorbed along with water and then NaCl. And that is because of presence of UTA 1. Okay, this thing you must know actually write in your exams. Okay, now finally, so we have seen how this medullary interstitium is created. So we saw a single effect that is going to multiply continuously. We saw the roles of different participants in countercurrent system. Now finally, coming on to countercurrent exchanger, this is actually responsible for maintaining the medullary interstitium. What is the meaning of maintenance? Which means, this constituents that I am sending to the medullary interstitium should not circulate within that structure. It should not escape away from it, right? So when it can actually do, when it has a blood supply. So please understand, your medullary part is going to be supplied with some blood vessels that is arising from efferent part of efferent arteriole, and that is called as your vasa recta. And this structure is going to help in your maintenance of your medullary interstitium. Okay, so if you take the descending limb, okay, same story, descending limb is permeable to water, ascending limb is permeable to electrolytes. Okay, so if you take this descending limb of vasa recta is going to arise from the cortex and then it is going to reach the medulla. Okay, it is going to reach the medulla. So if you take down the region from your cortex to medulla, your medulla should be at an higher concentration, right? So which means there has to be some maintenance, recirculation of solutes or whatever it is, right? So what is going to happen actually? This particular medullary gradient is going to be created by allowing solutes inside and by having exit of water. Please understand this point. Your descending limb is going to supply the medulla, so which means the this limb also has to be concentrated. So how this limb is also concentrated is by allowing the solutes inside and by giving out water outside. Okay, so thereby what is going to happen? Your medulla's the descending limb is also going to continuously, the concentration is going to decrease, and this is actually going, this is what is going to actually supply the medullary interstitium. Okay, so please understand, Ipo, whatever we saw in medullary interstitium, you have this component present. All this is supplied only by your blood vessels. So ultimately, the constituent should be present inside the blood. Okay, so this descending limb is going to supply the medulla with such a concentrated fluid by means of allowing the solute to enter and allowing the water to exit via your descending limb of vasa recta. Similarly, if you take ascending limb of vasa recta, it's just going to supply the cortical region. So cortex, what has to happen? The fluid has to be hypoosmolar, right? So which means the concentration has to be less. So what is going to happen? It is going to allow the water. You come, water come, and it leaves the solute out. This solute is again going to medullary interstitium. So this is how actually the interstitium fluids are going to stay within the interstitium. Are able to understand? அதாவது இருக்கிறது சுத்தி சுத்தி ஒரே இடத்துக்கு வரணும். அது எப்படி வரும் ஒரே இடத்துக்கு அப்படின்னா, only by means of a blood vessel, and that blood vessel is going to be your vasa recta. So this is a point that you must understand. Okay, now coming on to a very important aspect which I wanted to especially focus on is on applied physiology. So if you take diabetes, we all know we have two things, diabetes mellitus and diabetes insipidus. Okay, so diabetes insipidus is concerned with this ADH. Okay, so like how we have diabetes mellitus, we have type 1, type 2. Type 1 will be having complete absence of insulin. Okay, because of this, especially in engaged, because of this acute pancreatitis, okay, alcoholics, so all that. In type 2, insulin will be there. The insulin secretion will be there, but the receptors are is masked because of obesity. Okay, or there are some other factors that is not actually, cells are not able to intake this insulin because of lack of receptors or some other thing that is happening inside a cell. Okay, so type 1, complete absence of insulin secretion. Type 2, insulin secretion is present. Similarly, if you take diabetes insipidus also, I told you, which is going to involve ADH. So we are having central diabetes insipidus and nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Central diabetes insipidus means the problem is with the center, which means due to absence of secretion of ADH. Okay, so central diabetes insipidus, we are not going to have any ADH secretion, and that is called as diabetes insipidus. Okay, and then if you take nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, we have this ADH secretion, but the kidney is not able to actually receive this ADH. Like how we saw in a cell, insulin receptor will be present that accepts the insulin and that is going to favor the uptake of insulin into the cell. Similarly, if reabsorption of water has to happen, there should be a receptor present on the tubule that is going to actually accept the ADH and allow the function to happen. That is not going to be there. So if there is some pathology involved with your kidneys, then it is called as a nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. And if there is some issues with the center itself, then it is called central diabetes insipidus. So for central diabetes insipidus, the drug of choice is desmopressin, that is going to be analog of ADH. Okay, here we do not have ADH. So you are supposed to supply a substance that is going to mimic the action of ADH. So the drug of choice is desmopressin in case of a central diabetes insipidus. And if you take a nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, it is going to be diuretics, especially like your thiazide, sodium, and then we have furosemide. Okay, that is mainly going to act on furosemide. So this is actually acting on your NaK sodium. Okay, sodium potassium chloride channels. Okay, thereby it is going to facilitate the water reabsorption. Okay, so furosemide is an important diuretic, and apart from that, you can write thiazide also. Okay, so we have a central diabetic insipidus and nephrogenic diabetic insipidus. Okay, so this is applied physiology. So I hope you all understood. Okay, so you need to talk about, okay, what are the substances that are involved. Okay, so this is where your question will actually start. You should define requirements about countercurrent multiplier exchanger. Countercurrent multiplier, please do not forget to highlight the single effect. Okay, and you should tell what is a single effect. Okay, so this diagram again, please try to draw. Okay, very simple diagram if you would have understood. Okay, and then please do not forget to mention the role of urea. Vasarecta, again I told blood supply, so this is just going to circulate the constituents within the medullary interstitium. So that is why we have this exchanger. Okay, and finally applied anatomy. Okay, so I thank you all for attending my session. Okay, I do not have a thank you slide again, sorry for that. So if you have any doubts, please try to post in comment section. And this is a very important essay question, so please try to revise it immediately after the video, or you can even revise it along with the video. Okay, thank you.